is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. If you're a regular listener to the show, let me take a minute and say thank you. We currently have listeners in 168 countries, and I just want to express how much I appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you for the privilege of your time, and it's my goal to provide you with useful information each and every week on the Thriving Dentist Show. If you're a new listener, let me take a minute and say welcome. Welcome to our community, our tribe, our thriving tribe. The goal of the Thriving Dentist Show is to help you develop a practice that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. My guest on today's show is my friend, Dr. Paul Goodman, and our topic is the importance of community for a thriving dentist. You know, I have a mentor in marketing, and his name is Seth Godin. It's likely that you've heard of Seth. If you have not, I would encourage you to Google him and perhaps put him on your radar, and he can become a mentor of you as well. The term that Seth uses for community is tribe. I like that word a lot. Dr. Paul Goodman and I are going to talk about the importance of developing a community or a tribe of colleagues to help you thrive. But before we get to that interview, we have another segment of Top Clinical Tips from Dr. Leanne Brady. On this Top Clinical Tip, Lee is going to share one of her favorite products that she uses in her office. You'll enjoy this Top Clinical Tip from Dr. Leanne Brady.
So my top clinical tip for today is going to actually relate to my top clinical tip from the last time, which was about etching zirconia. And I mentioned a product from Ivoclar Vivadent that's called Monobond Etch and Prime. And so classically, when we want to etch ceramics, we use something called hydrofluoric acid. And hydrofluoric is pretty funky chemistry, and I don't actually like to have it around in my office, and you have to wear special protective equipment. You don't want to get it on you or the patient. So in order to get away from hydrofluoric acid, unless you've been milling in your office where you had to do your own etching, lots of folks have the laboratory etch the ceramics. And then if you have it already etched and you try it in, then you have to have a way to clean it, and then you have to silanate it or prime it. And so there was a lot of steps. So Ivoclar came out with this product a couple of years ago, and it's really in my top couple of products that I've learned about because it's a one-bottle system, and it's actually a self-etching silane or a self-etching primer. So they actually designed it specifically for their lithium disilicate, which is called Emax, but it also does work on lucite reinforced or on feldspathic ceramics. And what I love about it is, number one, I get three things in one step. So instead of having to etch and then having to clean and then having to silanate and having three different bottles of chemistry, I have one bottle of chemistry and it does all three of those things. It's absolutely impossible to over etch the ceramics. So I actually don't have to know, did the lab etch it? Didn't they etch it? Did I etch it and I forgot I etched it? So I can just put it on even if the glass has been etched before. It's a turquoise liquid. It's super simple. You're just going to shake the bottle, put it in there for 60 seconds. If you leave it for 60 minutes, it's still going to be okay, but minimum of 60 seconds, rinse it, dry it, and now the glass has been etched. It's been cleaned and it's been silanated, so you're ready to go. So not only is it really easy and convenient and kind of foolproof, and it saves me from buying three bottles of chemistry, the other thing I love about it is that it's actually safe enough to use for intraoral. So if you've got, let's say you're going to put an Invisalign button on, or you're going to put a bracket on for ortho, or you have to do a ceramic repair. All of us get somebody who comes in with a corner of veneer fractured off. You can actually use this product in the mouth. I will suggest that you put a little barrier on the gum tissue. The chemistry won't hurt the gums or burn them or anything, but it likes gum tissue, and it's kind of tricky to rinse off with an air water syringe tip. So I actually just coat it with a little petroleum jelly or use a little of the liquid dam from my bleaching system. And it comes right off. So if you've not checked out Monobond Etch and Prime, whether you're milling in your office, it's a must-have. Even if you're not, this is a great product to have in your office.
Well, as I mentioned in the intro, my guest on this Thriving Dentist Show is my friend, Dr. Paul Goodman. Hey, Paul, how are you?
Hey, Gary, how's it going? Great to be here.
Hey, it was awesome seeing you a couple weeks ago in Philly. And wasn't that Philly Splash meeting a lot of fun?
Oh, I loved it. I mean, it was just, I mean, to me, it was a perfect type of CE with a blend of clinical practice management, John Coyce, you, Jason Olitsky. I just thought was just so honored to be on a speaking stage and lineup with people that were so great.
Hey, how about our friend, Dr. John Coyce? Let's give him a shout out. Wasn't he amazing?
I mean, I love everything about him. I actually, you know, not everyone knows this, but I got into speaking mainly because of him. It was 2004 in the Hinman, and I was hearing him speak, and, you know, I've incorporated a lot of things he's taught into my dental practice and life. And I loved how he merged, you know, books and stories and things about Starbucks and taking his car into dental care and dental patient interaction. So he was just awesome as always.
Oh yeah. And what a genuine guy. In fact, you and I had an opportunity to have dinner with him the night before on Thursday evening, and just what a genuine good guy, huh?
Yeah, for sure. And I know that, you know, I mean, I was honored to be there with all of you guys, and I know he's involved in probably, you know, that's his 1,000th dinner like that, but he just was so engaged. And I do want to say one thing I really am proud of. When he was very gracious in the beginning, and he talked about the speakers, and I was the last speaker. You know, he was saying he was going to hear from, you know, someone like yourself, Gary Takis, you know, well known what you do, Jason Olitsky, and what he was doing, photography. And then he goes, I'm going to hear from Paul Goodman. He's going to talk about dental nachos. And I, you know, said to him afterwards, I don't think that he's ever said that about a person. So I felt honored to be that unique.
You know, a funny little sidebar. My wife happens to really enjoy Motown music. Right. She likes all different kinds of music, but she has a special appreciation for Motown. A couple of years ago, we were in Vegas for a dental meeting, and I took her to see a Gladys Knight show. And cool. Gladys Knight has her own theater in one of the hotels on the Strip. And, you know, it's a Gladys Knight theater. And this was, you know, her 8 o'clock show, you know, in the evening. And my goodness, that must have been her, I don't know, 5,000th show or something like that, you know, that she's done. And what was so cool about it is when she came out on stage, she was so engaged with the audience. It was almost as if it was like the first time she was ever on stage, and it was amazing. And I kind of felt the same thing about John, you know, that, like you said, he's given, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of presentations, and yet he poured his heart into it. And same with the dinner. I mean, he's had to have gone to many, many, many dinners like that, but he was fully present and fully engaged. And so if any of you listening are, you know, ever have an opportunity to listen to Dr. John Coyce, run, don't walk. You'll be well rewarded.
I totally agree. I mean, it'll change your dental life, even if you get just a chance to see him for an hour. And it's seeing someone live like that is just so special. So if you see that, have that opportunity, I totally agree with you, Gary.
You bet. Hey, and we're going to talk about nachos. And for our listeners that aren't familiar with the context, they'll get the context later. But hey, one of my favorite foods.
Yeah, right.
Right. Everybody's right.
Yes, I think it's the most beloved food out there. So, you know, I picked a good one.
So we're going to talk about nachos, and we're going to tie this into dentistry, and we're going to have a lot of fun. But hey, it was just really fun seeing you in person. Your presentation was amazing. You know, it's always hard to be the last speaker on a conference, but you closed it out in a fantastic way. So great job.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. The meeting planner said something like he was saving the best for last, and I was just joking. I don't know if that was the case, but I know that's tough 4:30 on a Friday, but I really love speaking too. And, you know, I would even do it to a room full of 10 people. So it was just great to be there, but I appreciate you saying that.
Yeah, you did a great job. Well, hey, I imagine that many of our listeners will know you or know of you, but we have listeners in 168 countries now.
Wow.
And so all over the world, there'll be many dentists around the world that don't know who Dr. Paul Goodman is. So we get to this is kind of like your debutante.
Oh, thanks.
Did you do your hair?
I was actually, I know you'll bring up later, but Pasquale Venuti and you have the same hairstyle. So, you know,
we're follically challenged.
Yeah. It's a cool look though. I know it's low maintenance. I like it.
That's right.
I'm a high maintenance hair guy. So, you know,
there you go. I'm the opposite.
So, yeah.
Wait, would you mind, as we dive into our interview, would you mind sharing a little bit about your backstory, in particular, how you came to be interested in dentistry and became a dentist. And then I'd love to hear, you're a 2002 graduate of Penn there in the state of Pennsylvania, and how what life has been like after dental school for you. So mind tell us a little bit of the backstory.
Oh, sure. I'd be happy to. I have to go back to 1993. I'm 40 years old, so I consider myself a medium-aged person and dentist. And I was, in high school then, and growing up then, I wanted to do three things, be a lawyer like Tom Cruise from A Few Good Men. I love that movie. Or George Clooney from ER. I felt, he was very well liked by the ladies. So, that was a good job to have a doctor like him or a dentist like my dad. And I was going through it always like kind of science classes, not sure exactly what I wanted to do. And I went to Villanova to see the campus, and they had a pre-dental program where you could do 3 years at Villanova, 4 years at Penn. You would not have to take really interview, and your DAT scores were not as critical as if you were, graduating after college. And my dad growing up, just an awesome dad, awesome dentist. We got a chance to work together for 11 years, best friend, unfortunately passed away 2 years ago. But I feel very lucky to have had that experience. And what's interesting, my brother's a dentist too. And he was just the greatest dad because, he didn't pressure us into really doing anything. But the only thing he said to me when I was thinking about all this was, that he just really liked being his own boss. He said, you have a lot of control. And of course, growing up, he was the dad who coached a lot of sports teams and could manage his schedule to be there a lot and had a day off during the week. And of course, as we'll dig into, there's a lot of stress involved with that. Sometimes I think, 10 years as a dentist, Gary, is like 40 years in normal person working years.
It's like dog years. It's like dog years, right?
Say that. Yeah. So, the more you do it, the more you really realize that. So I had applied to that. I did the 7-year program, love Villanova. I like being at Penn in Philadelphia. I've stayed in Center City ever since. Our practice with my brother, we have two practices in Mercer County, New Jersey, but I'm just a city type guy. I love walking around. I, have a shared workspace for Dental Nachos. I don't know. Wait, what's the right word? Lazy or efficient, right? It's all about word choice.
Right.
You're very, very efficient. It's kind of mean lazy. So I've enjoyed that and I'm married and have a 4-year-old and another daughter on the way. But my, journey through the college process was great. First 2 years of dental school for me were fairly good. I mean, a lot of book work and, the pre-clinic and the clinic stuff I had a lot of struggles with, because what's interesting is I don't know why they do this, Gary, but like you don't get a chance to practice any of the dental stuff until like a year and a half into dental school.
Right.
And I actually think that's a big problem. I've talked about it in some of the group because I think they should incorporate that more up front for a variety of reasons. A, just for more practice. And B, the skill set that you need to get into dental school with being really getting good grades in science courses don't really have that much to do with being a dentist. So it's interesting. That part was a challenge for me. I'd gone to my dad and
don't use the periodic chart of elements every day in your practice?
I always say my lectures, like so far, I've had a lot of patient issues and the Krebs cycle has not gotten me out of a jam yet. patient's going to say, I don't like my denture. I'm going to say, well, here's the Krebs cycle. Went to my dad and I don't even tell the story that often. It's not that dramatic, but I said, I don't know if I'm doing the right thing. And, I have all these, I have other talents and maybe I should be involved with writing. And in college I had all these professors in sociology and psychology and philosophy said, you're good at this. Do you want to do, be a professor? And of course, then the romantic notion of a college student, sometimes that sounds kind of cool because you just got to live on a college campus the rest of your life.
Right.
And my dad was just also then great. He said, listen, I will support you with whatever you want to do. I know you're frustrated. I do want to tell you two things. One, that, you did really want to be your own boss. And it reminded me of that gently. And two, what was really important was none of this stuff that happens in dental school matters after dental school. He goes, dental school for him was the same way. And, since he was such a trusted advisor, and we can talk about those things, what it means to have someone you trust of their opinion enough to give you feedback you might not want to hear, but still supportive. And I stuck with it and I'm really glad I did. I went to the Albert Einstein GPR. I'm a big fan of post dental school training. I stayed there for a multi-year GPR and did a lot with dental implants in 2002 to 2005, which was just life-changing for me. I got to place and restore over 150 implants, which now, Gary, I know you do a lot of high-level consulting with these practices. But back then, that's a long time ago. That was pretty controversial to have a general dentist doing a lot of implants.
Oh, holy cow, yeah. Yeah,
but Albert Einstein, Philadelphia.
You were really on the leading edge of what we're seeing a lot more of today, but that was not common then, that for sure.
And I just feel lucky that the program director there was just said, I don't really care what the status quo is. I'm going to teach these general dentists about implants and let them use it however they see fit. And he did it in a responsible way. And Albert Einstein in Philadelphia, where I still teach, and I'll be teaching the residents tomorrow, it, to me, it represents everything that's great about dentistry. I mean, there's an endo clinic, there's a GPR clinic, there's an ortho clinic. And while you get a group of any, you know, professionals or anyone in one area, there can be some friction. It's just really everyone is supports each other and we learn for the right reasons. Nobody makes any money. That's part of the problem, right? I mean, it's in a hospital. So, you know, we all love being there. But if you had to look at the P&L of this, like, they couldn't sustain itself in private practice.
No.
But from a learning environment, you know, people like our attendings go back and teach, and you just, I always say this, it's kind of like a cult, but it's a good cult. Can there be a good cult, Gary? I don't know.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I think it could, a community. We're going to get to community.
Right.
So that's a tribe, saying, you know, a tribe, right?
Tribe, yeah.
Maybe
so
a tribe.
All these attendings go back there till, you know, me, I've gone back my whole life, and it's one of my favorite things to do to, you know, teach there. And, so after that, I joined my dad in private practice with his partner. One thing that was always impressed upon me was my dad loved having a partner. He said, you know, I like having someone cover vacation. I like talking to another dentist. So I did notice that, you know, most dentists work by themselves. So my dad just having a partner was unique and
right.
spoke to him and his partner's ability to get along, because it's like a marriage that lasts your whole career. And if it just lasts, that's successful.
Right, right. Well, I don't know if you, heard the mass exodus on our listeners when you said that nothing that happens in dental school matters. But I think we lost all 64 deans of the dental schools in the United States.
Yeah, sorry, guys.
But I'm kidding, because although my dean, you know, I teach on Mondays at Midwestern School of Dental Medicine out here in Glendale, Arizona. My dean is Dr. Brad Smith. I've had Brad on the show as a guest, and I think, and I'll challenge you a little bit in that there are some progressive schools today that are teaching some things that actually do apply in real live practice. And
I know that you get to teach, but I'll bring something up that we learned about with John Coyce, and like, he's just so great. So what he said was, we have very little standardization. So one dentist is doing something and another dentist thinks it's malpractice. So since we have very little standardization, the same thing happens in dental school. So while I think it is just totally awesome that you get to teach a practice management course at your school, that's just not happening at other schools. And
I'm teaching, in addition to what would be the kind of the more standard practice management curriculum, I've brought in a curriculum to Midwestern that is the people side of dentistry, the human side of dentistry. And, all of it, in fact, if I could summarize, you know, what I spend 4 years, I get to teach, all 4 years, D1, D2, D3, D4. It's a slide that I credit. I learned it from Dr. L.D. Pankey. And it's one slide. It literally properly summarizes what I teach over that 4 year period of time. And it goes like this. And you've probably heard this, Paul, but it says, always remember that there's a person attached to those teeth. And that may sound very simplistic and obvious, but if you really embrace it and you embrace the humanistic people side of dentistry, along with mastering the clinical sciences, you have to do good dentistry. But if you can master the people side and develop connections and develop rapport and relationships, then you're really building a foundation for an amazing career.
Well, I think you guys have a great model there. Your dean, I give him credit, and should spread to other deans, because what's happening is, the real name of the game when you get out of dental school is to run a business with a lot of people in it. Mm-hmm. And you need to learn how to deal with people. And if you don't learn that in dental school, and they say you're just going to learn it after dental school, sometimes the stakes are too high when you're in a practice. So I think your dean should share that with the other deans. The one thing that I will say is must be difficult is the schools have to get the students ready for the boards, right?
Okay.
And the boards, if you use, I mean, I'm a terrible dancer. I mean, I'm not even a terrible dancer. I'm a non-dancer. Like the boards, it's like, you know, right now my daughter takes hip hop in Philadelphia. It's so cool. She's learning all these things. Yeah. And that's pretty popular dance style. And hip hop is great. It is about community, and it's about feeling good and supporting each other. But the deans, like, they have to teach the dental students the Charleston, even though no one does the Charleston anymore.
Well, to amplify that. So Dr. Smith and I have had many conversations around this. The curriculum has actually been so popular that the students, my curriculum with the people side of dentistry, the students want more of that in the education. And I'm all, you know, very, very much on board with doing that. The problem with it is that if we were to add more classes related to the stuff that I'm teaching, then something clinically would have to be displaced. And I don't agree with that because ultimately they do have to pass the boards. Now the boards, you know, I'll jump on my soapbox for just a minute. The boards need to be reconstructed because the stuff that they have to do for the boards, it's not real world dentistry that they're practicing today.
Oh, I mean, it's, what's the other word for it? It's a horrific, the boards, because yes, they're doing it on people. So, I mean, no one's like, hey, could you show us how to take out an appendix to graduate from medical school? Oh, you've done it improperly. We're going to give you a bad grade. So, I mean, this is, I mean, all the things we're talking about, so exciting, and just how we have this, you know, dialogue here where, you know, it was my dad who said nothing in dental school mattered. So he was going back to dental school in the late 60s. So what was happening was, you know, the dental schools, they should cut out some of the clinical stuff because you have your whole life to learn how to do crown preps. Right. So you can practice that out in the real world, right? But what you can practice, Gary, is what you're teaching sometimes, right, how to talk to people. And it's rare that other dentists teach other dentists this. They need the Garys to do this.
I have a really fun story to tell. It was my first day teaching 7 years ago. And Dr. Smith had recruited me, and he spent about 3 years recruiting me to join the faculty. And he's a pretty relentless pursuer, and eventually just wore me down. And so I teach on Mondays, and I teach all four classes. So basically from 8 to noon, I'm teaching classes. You know, I have an 8 o'clock class, a 9 o'clock class, 10 o'clock class, 11 o'clock class. Then I have some lunch, and then I go into clinic. And that first day that I was teaching 7 years ago, you know, after I had lunch, I went into Dr. Smith's office and I said, well, now what? What do I do now? And he said, well, go over to clinic and coach the students over in clinic, like, you know, how they're talking to their patients, watch how they're developing rapport or not, and give them some advice. Well, this is what I do in my day job, in my consulting work. So, sure. So I go over to clinic, and the way we do it at Midwestern is the students are paired up. There's a D3 paired with a D4, and they practice together as a care pair team, an odd name, but they practice together as a care pair team for the entire year. And they alternate every other patient. So, you know, the first patient, the D3 might be the dentist, the next patient, the D4 is the dentist, and they go back and forth. And that way they always have an assistant. So they're practicing four-handed dentistry, you know, right in clinic. And so I walk over there and I'm observing, and I see two female dental students. There's a D3 and a D4. And I sort of migrate. I have a lab coat on, so they assume that I'm a doctor, right? And I migrate over to their suite and to their operatory, and I just observe. And I noticed that it was just kind of one of those beige experiences with the patient. You know, the patient was just there. There wasn't anything exciting going on. There wasn't anything positive going on. It was just kind of happening. Right? I mean, we all have had that experience.
Yeah, because you're thinking about so many things as a young dentist, it's hard to remember. You know, you're trying so hard not to fall down on a clinical thing.
Right.
Not think about how to talk to the patient.
Well, so then the patient leaves, and I slide into the operatory. This is my first day, so they didn't know who I was. So I introduced myself to the two dental students, and I noticed that the D3 was the student. I introduced myself to her, and I said, oh, what did you just do? And she said, Mr. Takis, I did a two surface filling on number 7. I said, oh, okay. How'd it go? And she said, well, I think it went well. The instructor checked it off, and I think it went okay. I haven't heard anything bad. I think it went okay. I said, oh, okay. And so then I deliberately positioned myself in front of the computer screen so she couldn't see it. And I said, I just have some questions for you. What was your patient's name? And she went to look around me to try to see the screen. I said, well, I'm blocking the screen so you can't see it. And she kind of looked down, and I said, where was she from? And what are her hobbies and interests? What does she like to do? How long has she lived here in Phoenix? And she looked up, and she kind of had these big eyes, kind of sad eyes. And she said, Mr. Takis, I'm really embarrassed. I was so focused on doing that two surface filling on number seven that I can't tell you her name, and I have no idea where she's from. I don't know if she's married or not. I don't know what her hobbies and interests are. I don't know where she lived before Phoenix. And I said, listen, don't feel bad. I'm not going to report you.
The thing is, and this is, I think, so great. And this great story telling me is, first of all, we train dental students to only care about what they're tested on. But then when you're out of school, you're not tested on this stuff anymore.
Right. Right.
We actually, I believe, waste their energy and young minds memorizing stuff you could Google.
Right. I told her on this, I said, don't worry, I'm not going to report you. And furthermore, but I want you to really remember something. And that is that, in your career, you can go through your entire career and not know your patients' names and not know if they're married or not. No. And you'll bump into a glass ceiling in terms of your potential. But if you will embrace the people side of dentistry, I said, by the way, her name was Linda. She's married. She loves baseball and she's originally from Minneapolis, St. Paul. And she looked at me and she goes, how do you know that? I said, well, I did look on the schedule to get her name, but I looked on her left hand on the ring finger and guess what? There was a ring. So guess what that means? She's right. Married. Furthermore, she was wearing a Minnesota Twins t-shirt. That's a baseball team. Guess what she likes? She likes baseball. And if she's wearing a Minnesota Twins t-shirt, guess where she's probably from? She's probably from the Midwest, in particular, probably from the Twin Cities. And she kind of smiled and I smiled. But I had this feeling that you ever had this feeling, Paul, I had this feeling that I was getting through to her, that something was clicking. And it was really interesting because throughout that entire year, every time I'd go over to clinic, I would deliberately make a point to come to her operatory. She would always, after that day, she always invited me into her operatory and she'd say, oh, Mr. Takis, let me introduce you to my patient, George. George is originally from Chicago, but he loves to play golf, could only play golf about 5 months of the year in Chicago. So he moved out here 10 years ago. He now plays golf 4 times a week. He's an amazing golfer. And George would be sitting in the chair, just kind of beaming, you know, saying, I got a great dentist, man. I got an awesome dentist.
Yeah, right. I think that's awesome. You changed her life. You helped her make more money, have more fun. I mean, I share a lot of these things with my residents and dentists I teach. I mean, I use this example. One of the hardest things to do as a general dentist is to go into a hygiene exam, make someone like you in a minute, check their teeth in 3 minutes, and then get out of there and still seem likable, right?
So, about a tough challenge. Well, it's interesting. So I followed her, obviously, through all of D3 and all of D4 year. I stayed connected with her after dental school. She owned a practice in slightly over a year from dental school graduation, bought her first practice. Today, she has multiple practices. She actually has 3, and we keep in touch, and she is absolutely thriving in every aspect of the word. And I certainly don't want to take, undue credit for that, but I believe I sort of lit some passion around the people side of dentistry for her, and it's been a wonderful success story ever since. Well, hey, I want to transition into the topic that I know you're passionate about, and I am too. And it's the importance of community for dentists. And let's face it, Paul, I'm not a dentist, so I'm going to have to sort of comment vicariously here. But I see a lot of dentists that don't have community. And as a result of that, they feel isolated and they can feel, somewhat alone. The old guard of community, the dental associations and organized dentistry, just, I'll be blunt about it, it just doesn't have the relevance today that it did in previous generations. And yet you're a master at the topic of community. Can you talk a little bit about how you feel about community and why you feel it's an important element for every dentist to have in their personal and professional life?
Oh, sure. I mean, thanks for listening. That was a great story about Linda. And I do think you are a huge contributor to her success and happiness. I mean, for me, I was always an outgoing person. I liked having friends, playing sports. I mean, I'm still very close with the guys I graduated from high school with. So, in college, I had friends. That was normal and always would do things together. Now, when I got to dental school, the thing about dental school that's interesting, and it's sometimes sets dentists up for even more isolation. Because, being a dentist, and you've been in many solo general practices, right, Gary? Yep. I mean,
you can be surrounded by 2,200 plus practices. I've had the privilege.
That's amazing. And yeah. You know, you see it, you could be as a general dentist, a solo general dentist, or sometimes even if you have a partner, but most are solo, you could be surrounded by people all day and still feel very lonely. And the reason for that is you're the only person who can do all the things that need to be done in that office. So, also a lot of times what's, you know, kind of poignant is, you know, the front desk is there. They have a little community, right? They're talking to each other.
Right.
The assistants have a little community. The hygienist, you know, they work in their room too, but they talk. But the dentist is kind of going around like a pinball all the time. No one really cares about that person, right? So I think that, you know, we leave dental school and you go into your own areas. Most people went to their hometowns. That's changing now. You don't know the other dentists in your hometown easily. Without these associations, I started by building this community in Philadelphia way back in 2005. I started something called the Rising Dentist Study Club. This is well before Facebook, but my concept, and this is a totally true story. I should find an old flyer. I said, I want to start this study club. I'm a general dentist. I'm young. I have no referral relationships. And this is the truth. I want to start this study club so that dentists do not hate each other in 10 years. I said, maybe it was really like a genuine mission. Maybe that if I could get dentists to come right after residency or early in practice, we could all be friends in Philadelphia and we would change the conversation of how we treated each other.
Crazy idea.
Yeah, but the problem was I did that, Gary, but there was no Facebook and there barely was emails.
I mean, the world has changed, you know, and we have channels like Facebook, like Instagram, you know, to stay connected. In fact, I want to give some credit to our mutual friend and colleague, Howard Foran. You know, when Howard created Dental Town, and that was 1999, so coming up on 20 years, when he created Dental Town, one of the things that he created Dental Town for was to create a sense of community so dentists didn't have to feel like they were practicing alone. And I think Howard deserves a major credit for a very noble enterprise to connect dentists. Now, I will go on record, and I've told Howard this to his face, and I'll go on record as saying that. I think the big mistake that he made with Dental Town was allowing dentists and allowing anyone to post with screen names. And be able to hide behind a screen name. And that's one of the reasons why I think the forums and the communities and the groups on Facebook are so popular today, including yours. We'll talk about Dental Nachos, but including yours, because if I'm a member, of course, and if I go on Dental Nachos, I've got to post transparently as me. That's a terms of service with Facebook. So consequently, if I'm going to disagree with someone, and it's okay if we disagree, right? I'm going to disagree agreeably because I don't want to look bad, you know, in the dialogue. But sadly, I think Dental Town has become very vicious and it's become a small group of people, you know, really carrying on some very negative correspondence because they can hide behind a screen name. And I think ultimately it's why much of the dialogue has switched over to the social media channels, because you can't do that there.
I totally agree. I mean, if I met Howard Foran, I would love to shake his hand and thank him, because I have to thank him for two major things that have changed my life. One is that I met the lab technician I've used for the past 10 years on there. Cool. So that changed my life and my patient's life. So I appreciate that he put that form out there. Second was he helped me start to be this, what I call myself, this kindly annoying Paul was turning to Dr. Nacho, because on Dental Town, Gary, back in the day, this seems like archaic. You'd wait for the magazine to come out, and whoever's posts were in the magazine was kind of cool, right? You know, right. Like whoever thought, and mine were in there all the time, because I would do these polls and I would say stuff like, should you allow your periodontist to place abutments on implants, which doesn't seem so controversial now, right? But it used to be. So I would be this disruptive guy in truly a kind way to try to get people to think, but sometimes there'd be some collisions. But as I got on, as time went on, I agree, it got very rough and people were molar roller 225 from Anytown USA. That's would tell me I was an idiot. And I'm like, maybe, I'm like, could you, you know, this is what I thought when we were saying this, you know, people always say, put your money where your mouth is. Don't totally understand that, but at least Facebook, you got to put your face where your comment is, right?
Yeah. I mean, you cannot, I mean, I think Facebook, and other social media channels, foster civility in dialogue because of the fact that you have to show up as yourself. And I love that. Well, I want to take my hat off to you, or my sombrero.
Thanks.
Off to you, because of the wonderful work that you're doing to foster community. You know, one of the reasons why I believe in community as well, and I think this is true among the majority of our listeners, I believe that the majority of our listeners on the Thriving Dentist Show are abundance thinkers as opposed to scarcity thinkers. And what I mean by that is that when you're an abundance thinker, the world's not a zero-sum game. You know, in the zero-sum game, in order for me to win, you have to lose. And I so disagree with that philosophy. I was exposed to the concept of win-win very early in my career. And I think in dentistry today, through wonderful forums like Dental Nachos and other forums, it's allowing us to rise together with our colleagues. And there's no reason why, you know, here you practice in a very competitive state, New Jersey. My practice is in Phoenix, Arizona, one of the most competitive dental universes, you know, in the country. And yet there's no reason why we all can't be successful. There's still half of the adults in the United States don't go to the dentist. Let's go find some of them. So I love what you're doing, and I love how you're sharing your wisdom, and I love how you're encouraging your colleagues by providing resources and dialogue and thoughts, and even just to have open dialogues about frustrations. You know, let's face it, we've all had those days where we get there to the end of the day and we feel like we got run over by a truck. You know,
yeah. What you're talking about yesterday, because that was yesterday and the day before. I agree with you completely in this. You know, I don't know why. You know, one of my catchphrases is like, "No need to be so dramatic, Dennis," because it's like, you know, this whole win and someone else loses. It's just way too dramatic, and it's from the dental student Hunger Games they made us play against each other.
Right?
Stupid. And I mean, I actually am friendly with some of my friends growing up are just very, very bright guys, and they've gotten into the business world in a variety of ways. And they have circles where a lot of them are making a lot of money. My friends are still humble, but maybe that world could be deemed in a very competitive manner, the hedge fund, and they're all making all this money. Like, Dennis, we should want everybody to win because that makes a better community for all of us. Because I say this, these dentists now will say, you know what's going to happen? There's going to be like some boutique practices and the rest are going to be these giant corporate mills. But, you know, some people will survive the drought and they'll be fee for service dentists, or I'm just using an example, or they'll be fine, but everyone else is not going to be fine. And I'm like, I don't want to live in that world at all, even if I was the top guy, right? Because I went to my honeymoon in Paris, right? And there was an example of some history where they had a lot of kings, right, and queens, and then a lot of not so great, a lot of people downtrodden, and there was a lot of hedge chopping off of the top people, right? So I'm using a dramatic example, but I don't want to live in a world where it's so stratified that it's either you're doing great or you're doing terrible, because I don't think that's, A, that's just not a nice world to live in, and B, from a healthcare provider standpoint, I just, that's not going to be a good one. Yeah. So I think we should try to shape the conversation to find a way for all of us to survive, because that was my dad's generation, Gary. I mean, when growing up, I saw that it was like everyone did pretty well. Some people were, I would say, it's hard to define success. I mean, sure. To me, success is the most amount of nachos you can eat. So whatever that is, you know.
But the biggest plate of nachos.
You know, he had a tennis group of guys who played with him, and they were dentists, and it was fairly underwhelming in terms of, like, you know, nobody went to the dentist group usually and was like, I took spoiled guac PPO and my practice is terrible, right? They were all kind of hovering around the same way. And I think that was a great time and era, and it'd be great to try to recapture some of that. But we are facing some challenges from sometimes internal and external forces that are just making it more complex to run a dental business.
Well, let's talk about that, because you and I had a wonderful pre-production conversation. And, you know, we all know the term urban myths. Urban myths are these supposed truths that are put out there. And oftentimes, you know, these truths develop a life of their own when, in fact, they're not really grounded in reality. Talk a little bit, Paul, from your perspective, about some of the experiences you feel that young dentists are exposed to in terms of myths and perceptions about dentistry that, frankly, I think need to get out in the open. What do you think? Yeah, talk about that a little bit.
Share with a lot. I mean, what happens to me, and I really enjoy being this person, but I post a lot on Facebook, you know, dental groups. I mean, I don't want to brag, but I think I post the most of anyone. Gary, is there a word for that? I'm not sure. But I also get a tremendous number of private messages from people, which are private. And they're sometimes the not so great things that are happening. And they're asking for help, which I'm really am flattered to be this person. But those are the things that I don't share out of privacy. Sometimes I will share content without naming any names, just to share the reality that not everything is so great. But for me, I think that young dentists really need to find, and we were talking about stories, and they just need to listen to a high number of stories. So I'm just going to use an example where, you know, I was just meeting with a young dentist who graduated from dental school without a job. And I said, you know, just I'm asking, how come you didn't do a GPR or AGD? That's very popular in the Northeast. Mm-hmm. He said, well, I asked one of my dental school instructors. He said that wasn't necessary. And I dig a little more, and let's just, I don't know exactly, but let's say this dental school instructor is in his late 50s. And he said, just get out there and start practicing. That he could be trying to give him good advice. He could be giving him the advice that he had.
Sure, the intentions could be pure.
But it's not helpful to this dentist. So he actually was pointed. He said, do you think I could do a GPR now? And I said, no, the time has passed. Like, you could do it next year. But I said, next time when there's a decision, try to get some different stories. And in general, ask someone about 10 years older than you or 15 years older than you. Because, you know, we're talking like, if you wanted to find your mate or spouse, you wouldn't go to the local sock hop to do so now. You would use online dating applications. And I'm sure that online dating applications are going to be passe. We're going to use hologram dating applications.
right.
But dental students aren't really taught. I mean, you know, what you do and what some of my friends have done. And I worked in the restaurant industry as a server for many years. And they don't really know how to network and gather information. And they you know, I will be what I think is honest, and it might be a little tough love, but people go, and when they hear something they want to hear, they stop asking more questions.
Yeah, so, they got the answer they wanted to hear, and then they literally, you know, put it on a pedestal and, you know, start making decisions around that rather than getting a multitude of perspectives.
And, you know, you and I are, you know, I think real kindred spirits, and I've really enjoyed getting to know you, and I've listened to your podcast and your material. You know, I say to the Einstein residents when they come, or I say to anyone, like, I'm here to help you. Don't make me the only person you listen to. Gather information from everyone. But I say, you know, you shouldn't just trust me, but you shouldn't also not trust me, right? So right. Sometimes people, the dentist, they really, the pendulum swings very far for them. And for me, I think you just need to gather a lot of data on a decision that's going to be so life-changing for you. I talk about this too, Gary, like, should you be a specialist or not a specialist? Here's the deal. We sell practices, and we have periodontal practices where we can't find someone to buy a practice, and the periodontist makes $1 million a year because it's in Syracuse, New York.
Right.
But then I have a general dental practice where I'm selling a practice. I'm just kind of making this up a little bit, but $500,000 a year, and I have 20 dentists that want it the next day. So I just tell dental students, like, as you decide on your career, maybe you want to consider being a periodontist, right? Mm-hmm. And get some information, talk about that. And then people kind of claw back at me and say, but general dentists can do well too. But you didn't hear me say the general dentist couldn't do well, right?
Right.
I just said, consider this. So, you know, these stories that are being told to dental students, I think we just have to do a better job. Because, I mean, you know, remember when we were younger, like, I'll say to my daughter, you know, I'll be nice to you so you care for me when you're older, right? You know, you bring me liquefied nachos in my, you know, rocker.
Right. Yeah. blended nachos.
Yeah. Like, these younger dentists are going to have to take care of us for whatever, in whatever way that means.
Right.
You know, so we should take care of them now. I mean, that's just like, I always say in my lectures, I say, we're about to have a baby actually any day now, Gary.
Ah, okay.
And, that'll be fun. You know, just have a new human in your house, new roommate, permanent roommate. But, when you have a baby, what does everyone do? They rush over to help you, right? Because everybody loves a baby. But when you buy a dental practice, no one rushes over to help you watch your dental practice.
Not so much.
Yeah. So, you know, this, I think that we just need to do a better job of sharing the reality with dental students. And it kind of goes back to what you were saying. Most dentists work alone and they only can share their own reality.
Yeah. It was interesting. I had last week on the show a client of mine, Dr. David Stern. David graduated in 2013 did a 1-year GPR. And then he worked in 4 different associateships. And each one of them was in a very different type practice environment. So I really got to experience some different practice in environments. You know, one was a Medicaid-oriented practice. The other end of it, the other extreme was one was completely fee-for-service, and the other two were sort of blended practices with a mix of fee-for-service and PPO plans. And in each one, he learned different things. And he was highly motivated to own his own practice. He started listening to podcasts, became a client of mine, and ended up buying a practice in 2016, right at about the 3-year point out of dental school. And so it shows you that you can, if that is your goal, you know, to become a practice owner. And I am a big believer in entrepreneurship in dentistry. I believe there's many good career paths in dentistry, but I happen to think that the best possible career path is to own your own practice for the same reasons that your dad told you, Paul.
I still agree with that. And, you know, my dad towards the end of his life, he had admitted, you know, it was always challenging to run a practice because, you know, sure, you have a team and you have this because what you guys are doing, my brother and I, it's become ultra complex. I mean, he didn't really think that this would happen with all the insurances and all the challenges that we have. But I totally agree with you. It still is. And your client sounds just to be a great model because he did a GPR, practice in an environment with support. Then he got multiple experiences at different dentist restaurants.
With good, with good mentors, with good chefs, right?
And you know, good chefs. And then he did what he wanted to do. But he, you know, I don't understand some of these. I mean, maybe this is an interesting part of life. You know, someone says to me, do you make a lot of money? I'm like, I don't know. I can't really keep track of my money. I'm too busy. And, you know, it's a joke. But, you know, when you're in this medium age of life, you're having kids, you're doing stuff, you're taking trips, you're building businesses, it gets very chaotic, right? And then when you're young,
the merry-go-round spins pretty fast.
Yeah, and it's great. I mean, I'm thrilled to be at this stage of my life. But the younger dentist, you know, I remember when I was young, like, I just was an associate with my dad. I became a partner earliest, but, you know, I'd had this experience at GPR, but I didn't have all this responsibility. If I wanted to go on a trip, it wasn't a big deal. Like, I don't know why people want to rush into practice ownership. It's not going anywhere, right? Like, I mean, I think your client is just such a great example. He was made a lot of responsible, and my podcast partner, Rob Montgomery, who's an attorney, says this, it's responsible, and he made some very purposeful decisions, and it sounds like he's doing well.
And by the way, I want to get Rob on a future Thriving Dentist show. So would you plant a bug in his ear about?
For sure. Yeah. I love that. I can't be like, hey, Gary, do you want to be my new best friend? Cause you'll be like, oh, that's a weird thing to say. But, you know, I really enjoy connecting with people like yourself and Rob who are non-dentists. I always say this to Rob and I'm willing to offer this to you, Gary. You are in a practice all the time, so I think you see it, but you don't know what it's like, and you can't know what it's like to do a filling on number 15 when the person doesn't want to open.
Truth.
It's 3 p.m. on a Friday. So I'm going to try to create a camp for you and Rob to do that somehow. I just, he's the lawyer. He's got to work out the legalities,
right?
Like, you know, yeah, fantasy dentist camp. But you know, I'm joking, but I really enjoy relationships with people who are connected to dentists, but aren't dentists because they just bring a different perspective.
See, I wanted to own a practice and I could do that in Arizona. I found out I wanted to own a practice because I wanted to have a test kitchen where I could test concepts that I was teaching. I wanted to have a test kitchen where I could experience the ups and downs that you all experience every day. And you're right. I don't have the perspective of being the person that provides the care, like you do and your brother do. That's a whole different dimension that I can understand that intellectually. And I can understand it, I think, from a very personal level through Paul and Tim in my office. But I won't have that experience because I didn't go through that process.
I say as a joke, because I actually, you know, I'm just saying to Rob, one day I'm going to make it so that you can do a filling so you can see what we do, and I'll be happy to add you to it. But I always say this, you know, dentists are very dramatic. And, you know, on these groups, I might be like, you know, one of the warning signs that I see are that when I got out of residency, the starting salary for an associate and what associate made just as a broad picture, it was maybe like $120,000 a year, 2003. Sure. Now it's 2018 and it could be similar. So I'm just going to, my sharing is I see that as a concern because the loans are higher. But sure. A lot of the people online, they'll say, well, that's better than digging ditches, right? And I want to say, I'm going to get someone who digs ditches, bring them to the dental office and be like, I'd prefer to dig ditches, right? Because, you know, it's always just too dramatic, right? No, was my life be a dentist or dig ditches? And I mean, my point in saying this is the stresses that are involved in everyone's job, everyone knows them uniquely to their job, like speaking, you know, speaking well, right? Sure. Like, you know, you don't know what it's like to stand up in front of 100 people who don't feel like being there until you're a speaker, right? So, you know, you can share that reality. But I just think that, you know, dentists and this concept of community they've created, I think the Facebook groups, despite some of the messiness, despite, you know, like nachos, despite the messiness and despite some of the abrasiveness, I just think they're actually awesome because they're creating sharing. And I'm not a psychiatrist, Gary, but I feel like it's better to talk than not talk, right?
Well, so I have the hairline, so I can play Dr. Phil. I don't have the mustache, and I don't have the French blue shirt on today, but I do, as a coach, play my play the role of Dr. Phil on occasion. But hey, let's transition and talk about dental nachos. I want our listeners to learn all about dental nachos. So tell them what dental nachos is all about.
Yeah, sure. In 2017, Dental Hacks Nation was one of the first Facebook groups. I loved it. To me, it was like a new dental town because I kind of stopped being on dental town. Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, these groups were in their infancy, even though it was just a short time ago when this was happening. So I'm an opinionated person. I like to share my opinions. And I actually would like to say this up front. I truly believe that we're going through a different time in communication where I'll put a Facebook comment and people will get upset with it because they're reading it in their own emotional state and they're not hearing how I'm saying it as a speaker.
Yeah, because they're only getting the two-dimension, the words. They're not getting all the other aspects of communication that goes with the message.
Yeah, totally. And so much so that I'm actually, when people meet me, they describe me, you know, as a very positive, enthusiastic person and likable. And I was at the Voices of Dentistry and two guys who are well-known on Facebook, good guys, they came up to me after they heard me lecture on transitions. And they said, we want to meet you, Paul, the dental nacho guy. I just want to tell you that we really like you. And I go, oh, thanks. And they go, because we didn't expect to like you. I go, well, you could have kept that part in your head, right?
But you didn't have to say that part.
But I said, why? And they said, well, because your posts on Facebook, I feel, are negative. But you're such a positive guy. And I said, guys, they're not negative posts. They're just exactly what you heard in this lecture. But you liked all the humor and my body language and my facial expressions. And you knew it came from a place of caring where if someone says, hey, I think you have done XYZ too much, whether it's gain weight, gamble, or this. I care about you. Would you consider modifying what you're doing? But if you text that to someone, that comes off in a different way. So back to the nachos, I said, I'll make my own group. And, you know, it sounds crazy now, Gary. I said, maybe I'll get like a few hundred people and I can talk about implants and practice management. But it'll be my own group and I'll be in charge of it so no one can get mad
like
at what I
club.
Said.
Your own club.
Yeah, my own club. So my wife was awesome. I was thinking, what can we call it? I do love nachos. I was a kind of a chubby little kid. I used to go to this, whenever my parents said, where do you want to eat? I always picked a Mexican restaurant because they give you the free chips right away. So, you know, you sit down at a Mexican place, like here's some free chips and salsa. Then when I was in better shape at 19, I worked at a place that was like a corporate Mexican place. I learned so many things from my practice management there. I mean, first manual I ever read, customer service. That was awesome. And then I always just love nachos and margaritas. People love sharing them. I love sharing stuff. And I said, I'm like nachos because I'm a dentist, a speaker. I got into practice transitions. I do all these different jobs. So I said, I'm kind of like dental nachos. And I think, Gary, I mean, I'm not a good marketer for a lot of reasons. I like to speak, but I actually think I picked the most popular food on the planet because no one knew what the group was. So they were just posting pictures of their nachos and thrilled to do it.
And they still do that.
Yeah, it was like a happiness group. You know, it was like a group where people posting kittens, you know, puppies playing basketball or something. Right.
So, is Dental Nachos an open group?
I have to approve you.
So it's closed, but
not secret.
Yeah. You will. So someone requests becoming a member and then you approve them, then they're in.
Yeah, because my wife sometimes, she says this about me. She's like, you are too generous, you are too nice, and you always care about people. I'm like, that sounds like a nice thing, but the way you're saying it doesn't make it sound nice. She's like, you're very naive. So when she was kind of looking, I didn't realize, Gary, in the beginning, like people try to get into these Facebook groups and then sell stuff immediately. And sometimes they're selling like, you know, equipment from other countries. And it's like, it was just clogging up the group, right? Yeah. Because so I kind of have this thing where you just got to like, give me your email, tell me if you ever listen to the Dental Amigos podcast, and we approve you. So it's about 10,000 members now, which is,
you know, so cool,
beyond what I thought. But I really have made great friends. I've solved problems for myself and others. I've made great relationships. And, you know, I don't know, I went on a golf trip with my 8 friends from high school, and we said we fought a little. So, like, you know, there's always going to be some friction, but sure. I think the great good outweighs the negative. The rules are attack ideas and not people. So you've got to just be nice is one of our catchphrases. So you can't attack people. You have to try not to spam the group with advertisements if you never post.
Right.
And we have the updated thing. Remember when I was a kid, people would call like the cold call to sell you stuff, right?
But
I used to say to myself when I was eating, like, that must work for someone, or else they've never they have to stop doing it, right? But people just go on there and go to my course in Florida, right? And I actually nicely say to them, Gary, I'm like, listen, if you don't share in the community, no one's going to pay attention to your post. So whether I take it down or leave it up, no one's still going to pay attention. And I've actually got a lot of people to see that light. I've even told people, my wife's a kindergarten teacher who's on break, but sometimes I feel like her. I go on private message and say, hey, Bob, you didn't have to tell that person, not a joke here, Gary. Right. That was the worst case they've ever seen on the internet, right? Because that happened. So this, I'll tell you a quick story.
I know it did.
So someone posted a case that was disruptive, but I actually, being an implant guy, thought it was actually perfectly fine. So some of these other dentists, a little older than me, one guy said, that was the worst case I've ever seen on the internet. And I was like, oh man, why did you have to say that?
Apparently he didn't read Dale Carnegie's book, How to Win Friends and Influence People.
This is me, Gary, and I like being this person. And I don't always have to like turn the frown upside down. That was like a KB toy. Sure. I went on the private message. I said, hey, dentist, you're new to the group. We don't really say things like that. You know what he said immediately? Kick me out if you want. So me being like, yeah, I go, I'm not going to kick you out. You're not kicked out. You can come back on the group. And this is a great story. You can come back on the group and play nicely, or you don't have to be on the group, but I'm not going to kick you out. Right. So he said, okay, I'll see. I don't know if I can take these group rules. Right. Yada, yada, yada. Like Seinfeld. That dentist is coming to our Pasquale Venuti event because he likes dental nachos so much. And what I've created, it's become a big part of his life. So that's not the most dentist story.
That is a dentist story. Hey, tell our listeners, I like to think that our listeners are people that take action. So let me give an instruction to our listeners. If you're not already a member of Dental Nachos, I want to encourage you to become a member. I'm going to put a link in the show notes. The show notes are at thrivingdentist.com. I'll put a link there. It'll go right to the Facebook homepage for the group. Request to be a member. Jump in and Paul will approve you and you can now be part of this wonderful community. I also want to encourage you to listen to the podcast, the Dental Nachos or Dental Amigos podcast. I'll put a link to the podcast as well. And then Paul, if you would, as we're coming to the home stretch here, you've got a couple of cool events coming up. One in particular coming up in September. Talk about dentalamigos.com and what's happening there.
Awesome. Thanks for letting me do that. And, you know, my passion before this was creating live events for dentists to come together and try to be nice to each other. Not an easy task. So also dentists, they say that's a good CE course to go to, and they have 3 months. And then they say, oh, you know, it's my cousin's wife's sister's birthday. I'm like, you didn't know this before. And so I have these great events, the Union League in Philadelphia, which is a historic place. And we try to bring in really cool speakers. We bring in Dr. Pasquale Venuti from Italy, who's kind of like a mad scientist of composite, and he appeals to the dentist, Gary, because he really likes to save teeth now, and dentists love teeth. So he has these interesting restorative techniques, vertical preps. And so he's coming September 21st to 22nd. It's a 2-day event. There's a lot of food, fun, make new friends, and you could just sign up at thedentalamigos.com. And that is something that was great. We had to Corey Glenn in the beginning of the year, and we're going to have Pasquale Venuti at the end of the year. So that's the Dental Amigos. And It's supposed to be for medium age dentists, but anyone can come, right? You know, students, we have student discounts, we have young dentists. I mean, my goal, Gary, is that, and I really appreciate, like, we talk about community, is that, you know, you have some 40-year-old dentists with some 25-year-old dentists and some 6-year-old dentists, and instead of checking their phone at lunch, they could talk to each other and share some of their stories.
Crazy idea.
Yeah.
The cool thing about your Dental Amigos event is that you can, of course, come live, and I would encourage those to do that if they're able to do that. But you're also going to do live streaming.
We did that at our Dentist Boost Camp, which was just a few weeks ago for young dentists. And I tried this live stream, but I'm very lucky to have a tech team. I know nothing about tech, where they just did an amazing job it wasn't just like you were watching on TV. You felt like you were kind of there too. And that was a small group one. And for our larger one, for Pasquale Venuti, he's such a master chef of how to make the fresh pasta that you can sit at home eating nachos if you want, watching. You can get CE credit. It's for a really reasonable price. And my goal there is to kind of expand the community to this online platform. And you can actually ask questions. Hopefully you see the people live and join us live one time. And I just was thrilled to do this at the Boost Camp and glad to do it with Pasquale. And I really, you know, I know it's my event, but if I was not my event, I would sign up for it to watch Pasquale because what he does is...
He's a treasure. He's an absolute treasure.
And I'll say one thing, and thanks for saying this. I've made it so dentist, Gary, if you want to watch, want to listen, you get the live stream and you can watch it from home. But if you do have your wife's sister's birthday, we give you free recordings at the end after the
event. There you go.
No risk dentist favorite thing, no risk. So,
no risk.
I'm excited for that. And we, you know, I'd love to get you on one of our live streams from one of our events, like for the young dentist.
I would love to do that. Well, hey, I'll put a link to your dentalamigos.com in the show notes. That's coming up September 21st and 22nd. You have time to get there live, and you also have time to participate in the live stream. So let me encourage you to do that. Wait, Paul, I want to take a minute and say thanks. Thanks for all you do. Thanks for your commitment to our profession. Thanks for your commitment for community. I appreciate your humor I just appreciate your spirit. You've got a wonderful spirit, and it was wonderful to experience that face-to-face when we were together out in Philadelphia, but thanks for spending some time on the podcast.
Oh, the pleasure's all mine, Gary. And I was thinking, you know, I'll save this joke till the end, but, you know, I'm in Philadelphia, and we do have a lot of great history, and it is the founding fathers, and you really are like the founding podcast father. So it's a really special invite, and, you know, that's totally serious to be on this. And, you know, when I was just getting into podcasts, I was listening to yours, and you're just such an easygoing, great guy, and make people feel at ease. And, you know, I enjoy what you do for the dental world too. And I hope we can just sort of collaborate more and build a community together as the years go on.
You bet. Well, thank you. And you know, from our friends at the Voices of Dentistry, I've had a chance to be at both of their events, their inaugural event last year in 2017, and again this year, and I look forward to next year at 2019. They have tagged me with a nickname since I was the very first dental podcaster. They call me the Podfather.
I
wear that badge with honor. That's either because I was the first or I'm an old guy. I'm not sure. I'll take it. Well, hey, I want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but we couldn't do it without you. Thanks for all your support. It's my way to give back to our profession. There's three things you could do to support our work. Number one, tell a colleague about podcasts. There's many dentists have never heard the word podcast. Tell them about it. And hey, tell them about Thriving Dentist Show and tell them about Dental Amigos. Second thing, you can do is you can write us a review. You can go on iTunes and write us a review. That works for us very much like, say, a Google review works for your practice. Third thing you can do is you can subscribe. You can do that on iTunes, or you can do that on Google Play, or whatever the directory of choice that you favor for your podcast. Hit subscribe, and that means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically upgraded or uploaded for your listening convenience. On that note, let me take a minute and say thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big. as big as the ocean blue. When you dream it might come true. When you dream, dream